4. When the Apostle Paul was enlightened with that great vision, that manifestation of Jesus confronting him in the Damascus Road experience, everything about him had to be twisted. Everything. In fact, if today you go and speak to a Jewish person and you ask this Jewish person, who do you think, or what do you believe, or who do you believe is the suffering servant of Isaiah, they'll let you know. That's the Jews. The whole people, they have suffered. Aren't they a suffering servant? Who are these people that have been persecuted through the ages? The Jews. And those foundational moments were there even at the time of Paul. So when Jesus came and confronted him, whoa, he almost fell. Hey, you can hear me. That is great. They always tell me I can't talk because you can't hear me.
Okay.
Anyway, to go back, Paul had to start rereading the Old Testament again in order to find out, who is this person now that I am worshiping? It's so different. And he wrote in Galatians this wonderful text in chapter 4, verse 4, very quickly with me. Chapter 4, verse 4, and it says this. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. But when the fullness of what?
Time.
Of time had come, God sent whom?
His
Son. Didn't stop there, because he's going to answer the greatest quest for the greatest question ever. Why did Jesus come? And he says, God sent forth his Son, born of whom? Of a woman, born under what?
The law.
To do what? To redeem those who were under the law. The main reason that Jesus came, and he came as a little baby, was this wonderful mission to redeem everyone that was lost. To redeem that which was lost. That was the amazing reason. It's an enormous theological reason. So in this particular sermon, we're going to explore the theology behind the incarnation, the human story of the incarnation, and finally, what does it mean to you? The personal account of the incarnation. To Paul, this was an amazing deal. Did you know that for Paul, this was so great, studying all the different types of prophecies, that he wrote it in an amazing way? There are 61 prophecies concerning the Messiah. Did you know that? How many did not know there were 61? I like to see the hands. Well, guess what? I didn't know either until I started studying for the sermon. 61 prophecies concerning the Messiah. Now, there are a few prophecies that are still yet to be, you know, manifested because of the second coming. So, 61. Now, how many of you like math? Oh, look at that. And they're all guys. Right? Oh, there's the... Yeah, there's a guy back there. They you love math. Now, I was not very good at math. And one mathematician said that in order, check it out, in order for 8 of prophecies of the 61 to come true, in order for only 8 of them, he studied almost all the prophecies in the written, that has been written in all kinds of books. And it's amazing. There's a whole lot. In fact, in the 400 years that Christ was silent without no prophet before he was born, there were a whole bunch of books there that they were published just with prophetic enunciations of the Lord. But none of them came true. He said, this guy, I don't know how he did it, you know, but he said that in order for 8 prophecies to come true, the odds were 10 to what?
17th power.
To the 17th power. You remember this? The power? What does it really mean? Now, most of you know,
17 zeros.
There are 17 zeros after the one. Now, where is Austin? He told me he was going to help me. And, there you go. There's 17 zeros. You hold it there. He's a math whippersnapper here, right? 17 zeros for only 8 prophecies. That's it. That is 100 quadrillion for those of you. You know? And if we keep on spending in our country the way we are, we're going to get there. You voted for that. Right? Thank you very much. Those are the odds of only 8 prophecies being fulfilled. And the fact that prophecy after prophecy after prophecy was fulfilled, you can imagine the glory in the mind of Paul when he said, in the fullness of time, God sent his son. He knew what he was doing. He knew that. That promise was given to our first parents. You remember that? The promise. Come with me to Genesis chapter 3, verses 15. Most of you, most of us should know this particular promise by heart, because this promise was not given to us. Did you know that? We have it now. It's been adopted to us, but this promise was not given to us. It was spoken to our enemy. Chapter 3, verse 15. In fact, let's go to verse 14. The Lord God said to the serpent, who is he talking to?
Satan.
Satan himself. Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all the beasts of the field. And on your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. That was going to be the curse for this wonderful animal. Probably it had wings, probably it went from one tree to another, but now God was going to punish this animal. He had to slither the days of his life, eating what?
Dust.
And then he speaks to the devil himself. The greatest prophecy ever told was told to our enemy. I will put enmity between you, Satan, and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. There you go. The promise given to our enemy. You know, Satan, this is what I'm going to do. I am going to create a conscience. A conscience that is controlled by the Holy Spirit. Between you and every creature that will come upon this earth that is called humans. There is going to be a natural enmity, a natural distance between what you want to do, your government, your sins, and our conscience. And that is a gift that God has given every man and woman since the time of Adam and Eve. There is a conscience there. In fact, it was even there before he told Satan. When the serpent went to Eve and said, Eve, if you eat of this fruit, what's going to happen?
You will die.
You will not what?
Die.
You will not die. That conscience slipped in, and Eve told the serpent what? Hey, God did say that if we eat this fruit, what's going to happen? We're going to die. The conscience was working. And that's why it was very interesting that in the very first book of Genesis, it says that in the beginning there was God. You know, we had to learn that in the seminary. Barah, Bereshith, Elohim, it's whatever that means. In the beginning there was God. And then it says the Spirit of God, what did he do? He hovered over the waters. God gave us that great gift in order for us to fight the enemy, in order for us to have something in our heart that says, no, even though we like it, even though we fall into sin, there is something in our heart that says, I want to be right with God.
Amen.
Isn't that true?
Amen.
I want to be right with God. And sometimes, you know, being right with God is kind of quirky with different families and different cultures. Osama bin Laden wanted to be right with God, killing you and your children because you're Christian. So there are warped senses of this conscience. Nevertheless, God has given, according to Paul, this natural gift, this natural law that says there is a God and we need to be right with God. Therefore, God says there will be a Savior. There will be somebody coming over in order to save you. And it's interesting because when Adam and Eve conceived their first son, in the Hebrew, Eve called that son the man, not amen. The man. From that time on, every woman, believer of God, knew that the possibility of the Messiah coming within that womb was great. And she called Cain, who was the firstborn, the man. Here is the man. But the man was not the man. He was the crook. And this man was an envious person. And this man did not love God the way God wants to be loved. He loved God his own way. And therefore, she had to experience that great, great prophecy of death first on. How many of you ladies have lost a son or a daughter? How many of you? I would like to see the hands of those of you who have lost flesh from your own flesh. It doesn't feel good. I mean, no death feels right, but when we lose a son or a daughter, it is just not good. It is not good. I remember back living in New Jersey. I was just a little kid. I was 12 years old, 11 years old, and I remember that two Seventh-day Adventist kids were kidnapped. They were raped and killed and thrown into a river. And I remember going to that parent's home, and the father and the mother, they are laying on their bed in their master room, whatever that was very small, just crying inconsolable about these children. Nobody wants to bury their child. And Eve had to experience that. In the theological realm and in the realm of eternity, what Satan has created, it has been an enormous mess for us. And no matter what we do as a human being, no matter what, it takes a Savior to take us from step A to step B. It takes somebody going in for us and batting for us, a designated hitter coming in and batting for us. It takes somebody else. There is nothing that you and I can do to save ourselves, because this mess did not start on earth. Did you know that? So it took somebody out of this world to come and make things right. And it really hurts me that sometimes I go to churches and I see people within churches having the Messiah complex and figuring out everything in their lives. And if you don't do this and if you don't do that, then you're not saved. And we've planned these false scales that the Old Testament has about who's saved, who is not saved in church. And I'm letting you know, if there's anybody here that is doing that or has been taught to do that, stop it. And I can say that because I'm not the pastor here. Stop. There is a reason for the incarnation. In fact, if you go with me very carefully, now Paul did not make this up. God did not even told him these words. This was a hymn that was sung during Lord's Supper in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Very quickly, Paul wanted to explain that great, great condescension, that great incarnation theology to the people. And all he could do is say, hey, we sing this song every time we have Lord's Supper. Chapter 2, verse 5. Come with me to Ephesians. I'm sorry. It's not Ephesians, it's Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Who thought he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself. Can you believe that? The God of the universe made himself a DNA, a molecule. The Bible says you cannot contain the Godhead. And yet he emptied himself into a molecule. And the Holy Spirit began to grow this molecule in the womb of a young teenage girl. Imagine that. What a mystery. It's going to be explained to us through the centuries and eternity when we get to heaven. How in the world did this happen? How can God confine himself to a body, a molecule, a child, and then a man? How can he do that? Never, ever, never had been seen that he could do that. It took these measures way before sin ever started, the planning of salvation before, in order for us to understand. And Paul singing this wonderful hymn every time they did the Lord's Supper in the past with the apostles, who thought he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of what? A servant. In the Greek, is a slave, a doulos, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death of a cross. Here is Jesus Christ. And it's, you got to look at this particular passage. Every little thing in this passage, it called upon a decision from God. He had to now not look at his deity as something to be what? Grasped. He couldn't do that. He had to be thinking of others. He emptied himself, another thought pattern. He had to do that. And then when he became a human being, he had to think, I am a human being, and I am under the law, and I need to live this way in order to please God. Everything was made by decisions from God. Now, Paul is asking us to have the same attitude as Jesus Christ. That we being Christians and having everything, don't think that that's the all in all. But we must empty ourselves in order to help others less fortunate. That is the attitude. Not that we can be Jesus Christ, but we can be like Jesus in the attitude. And that was an amazing feat. Can you imagine? Here is God's answer to this dilemma of sin. I'm going to send my son. He's going to divest himself of power. In fact, he's going to sacrifice omnipresence in order to become a human being. Did you know that? And that's why Jesus says, I must leave so the Holy Spirit can come, because the Holy Spirit does have. Now, Jesus has it too, but he chooses not to have it. Omnipresence. And he can be anywhere. He can be in Africa, in the Philippines, in Cuba, in Moscow. He can be anywhere at the same time and deal with people cantankerous as us everywhere. The Holy Spirit can do that. But Jesus said, I will empty myself and I will have this particular limitation based out of a decision. And Jesus came. And when he came, it was amazing. I mean, what is the dream of every girl growing up? Tell me if it's not true, because I've heard this from girls, okay? The dream of girls, especially in the Jewish faith growing up, was finding that great man, getting married, starting a family. It's not what today sometimes, and you have to get a career, and you know, you gotta be independent, because a loser you may choose may leave you by the wayside. You know, if I had a